Well, if you were here Sunday, or at least heard the message on Sunday, we were looking at Jesus beginning a section of prophecy there in the Gospel of Mark. We talked about prophecy in certain areas. We mentioned this idea that sometimes prophecies have a dual fulfillment in the Word of God, where a prophecy in the Bible might be fulfilled in the near future to the time it was given, but also might have a far-outreaching fulfillment as well, typically centered around Jesus, either his first or second coming. But as I was teaching on Sunday, one of the things I did, I believe two or three times at least, is I referenced the book of Acts. And because the book of Acts is the one key book we have where we see the church in action. And that is important to learn from. God did give us the book of Acts. When Jesus walked the earth, the four Gospels, as valuable as they are to us, as much as we learn about God, about ourselves, about God's will, in no way am I putting down the Gospels, obviously, but always remember that all four of the Gospels, from beginning to end, all took place before the church ever began. The church, biblically speaking, is not simply all of God's people throughout all of history. We don't include people like David or Abraham or Moses or any of those guys in the church. The church had a very specific beginning in the plan of God. And it starts on Acts chapter 2, the day of Pentecost. The church will also have an ending one day in God's sight, and that will not be when the end of the world is all, but the church will have its ending. And so the four Gospels, we learn so much from them, but we're not seeing the church in action. We're seeing Jews under the law listening to their master who's explaining and trying to teach and showing all the ways that the scribes and Pharisees had taken people far from the will of God and trying to bring them back to an understanding. But it's in the book of Acts that we see the church in action. And of course, then it's in all those epistles in the New Testament that we have those direct teachings in terms of our lives. But seeing the church helps us understand those teachings, doesn't it? And I give this little introduction tonight because we have a subject, and it is still the subject of prophecy, but a different aspect than what we were looking at on Sunday with Jesus and the prophecies that he was speaking of. And we're going to see that as we get into this. So, Acts chapter 21, remember, Paul is traveling back ultimately to Jerusalem at the end of his third missionary journey. Last week, we saw him stop off and speak with the leaders of the church at Ephesus, and we saw his farewell message and looked at that in great detail. That's how chapter 20 ends. So as we begin chapter 21, and remember, Luke is, of course, not only writing the book of Acts, but also is Paul's travel companion at this time. So he will use the word we on regular occasion. So verse 1, now it came to pass that when we had departed from them, that's talking about the leaders in Ephesus that we just looked at, and set sail running a straight course, we came to Kos, and the following day to Rhodes, and from there to Patara, and finding a ship sailing over to Phoenicia, we went aboard and set sail. So we mentioned last week, you know, Luke in many ways, he's kind of keeping a journal, just telling us, hey, here's what we were doing, where we were going. But if you look at a map, you will see that what Paul is doing is he's traveling south and east, and we're ultimately going to Israel, right? And ultimately to Jerusalem. So all of these references you can find there on a map. So when we had sighted Cyprus, we passed it on the left, sailed to Syria, and landed at Tyre. For there the ship was to unload her cargo. Now, Paul didn't have anything to do with the cargo or anything like that, but he's a passenger on this ship. And so they're going to land, the ship is going to land at Tyre, which was a very influential trade city to the north of the land of Israel. And so that's where he gets off. And it says, he finding disciples, verse 4, we stayed there 7 days. So you find some believers and say, yeah, we've got time. We can hang out for a while. And what an honor and privilege for those believers to have Paul show up into town, right? And you're like, hey, you're going to stay a week? That's awesome, right? It'd be exciting. But look at what happens. And this is what we're going to have to wrestle with tonight. Verse 4. Finding disciples, we stayed there 7 days, and they told Paul through the Spirit, through the Holy Spirit, not to go up to Jerusalem. That's all it says. We're going to find out a little bit more in a few verses, and I'm going to come back to that, but just note it here. They're trying to convince Paul not to go to Jerusalem. And so we're going to have to look at why that might be. Verse 5, when we had come to the end of those days, so that week was over, we departed, went on our way, and they all accompanied us with wives and children till we were out of the city. And we knelt down on the shore and prayed. And when we had taken our leave of one another, we boarded the ship, and they returned home. So you get the kind of farewell, and they're going to say goodbye to him. And when we had finished our voyage from Tyre, we came to Ptolemais, greeted the brethren, stayed with them a day. And on the next day, we who were Paul's companions departed and came to Caesarea and entered the house of Philip the evangelist, who was one of the seven, and stayed with him. Now we're back in the land of Israel, there in the city of Caesarea, right there on the coast. And we're with Philip, who is described as the evangelist, but also described as one of the seven. Now, you might be wondering, what is that a reference to, one of the seven? Well, you may recall earlier in Acts, if you're familiar with it, and we of course, looked at it when we were there, there was in the early church a conflict of sorts, an issue that arose. And all of this is found in Acts 6, if you're taking notes. But I'm just going to read it. You know, we're not going to study it again. But just to summarize it, in those days when the number of the disciples was multiplying, this is in the earliest days of the church is all there in Israel and so forth, there arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists. Now, those were they were Jews, but they were very Greek-influenced Jews. At this point, no Gentiles had received or heard the gospel yet. They were upset because their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. They thought people were playing favorites in how they dished out the food or the help and so forth. And so the 12 disciples summoned the multitude of the believers and said, "It's not desirable that we should leave the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, who we may appoint over this business. We will give ourselves continually to prayer and the ministry of the word." The saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose 7 guys. The first listed for us is Stephen, who is described as a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit. And as you probably know and remember, Stephen also is the first martyr of the Christian church. He was put to death for that faith. The second name mentioned is Philip. That's all it says. And Philip, and then a bunch of other guys. But going back to what we're studying tonight, that's what it means by Philip, one of the seven. Same guy, and we pointed out then, and I pointed out again now, how even in a ministry of service like that, which is basically administrative, right? We're going to distribute, make sure everyone is treated fairly and so forth. Even in that role of the church, what was the qualification? We want people filled with the Holy Spirit. We want people guided and controlled by God. It's not just the people that are preaching the Bible. It's not just the people that are leading us in worship and song. No, no, no. Those who are serving the Lord in whatever capacity need to be led by the Lord, need to be filled with the Spirit, empowered by God's Spirit. That was important, even in an administrative sort of function. And look at what God did. Now, we don't know about all those 7 guys, but I already mentioned Stephen. He was elevated to be in the honor of the first martyr for Jesus. And then Philip, who is described now as an evangelist. So God's obviously used Philip in great ways. So that's where Paul and Luke and them are staying. And verse 9 tells us that this man, Philip, had four virgin daughters who prophesied. So he's got four daughters, four young daughters. They're not married off or anything yet. They're in his household with him. And it says they prophesy. Now, isn't that fascinating? You see, only in the Christian faith do we see women exalted to an equality with men. But you see, equality is not the same as there's no difference. God exalts women. How are women treated in the Islamic faith? How are women treated in Hinduism? You go places where Christianity has not had that influence, and you truly see how women are second-class citizens in a society. But in Christ, we are reminded that there is neither male nor female. Those distinctions in terms of, you know, who's better, who's got more worth, whatever, they go away in Christ. We are one. We are equal. That same passage that says there's no male or female also says there's no Jew or Gentile in Christ. Now, obviously, you either have Jewish blood or you got Gentile blood. That doesn't change just because you become a believer. And when you become a believer, you don't stop being a man or stop being a woman either. And the third aspect of that is there's neither slave nor free. Now, there's a real example, because just because you're a believer in Jesus Christ didn't mean that if you were a slave in the Roman Empire that you weren't still a slave the next day. But in Christ, even though slaves were far inferior to the free people in that mental aspect of society, that's not how God sees it. That's not how God sees it. And we see God using women in Scripture constantly. In the Old Testament days, sometimes, by the way, guys, it's because no men would step up. God had to use a woman because all the men were just like doing their own thing and weren't interested or whatever. Read the book of Judges, you see some examples of that. How about the resurrection of our Lord? Peter and all the rest of them up in the room hiding. Oh no, I hope they don't come after us. And the women going to the tomb. They don't care if the Roman guards or anybody else in the society knows that they're followers of Jesus. We want to pay our respects. We want to honor his dead body. They weren't expecting the resurrection, of course, but they were there at the tomb, and the men were all hiding for their lives. And Jesus showed himself to those women and gave them the privilege of sharing the good news with the men for the very first time. In the book of Joel, there is this prophetic reference, which is very significant because Peter, the day the church was born, the day of Pentecost, which, if you recall, the disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit and they began to speak in tongues, we call it. They were speaking in other languages. So that all of the people who were tourists in Jerusalem at that time, that were there for the festival, there for the feast, could all hear him in their own language. He said, wait a minute, these guys are all Galileans, they're all fishermen. How are they speaking all of our different languages? What's going on? Well, a miracle of God's what's going on. Now, some people said, oh, these guys are drunk. And I love the way Peter dismisses that idea. He says, it's early in the morning. I mean, what do you mean they're drunk? And isn't that ridiculous? Do drunk people all of a sudden have the ability to speak foreign languages fluently? How ridiculous. But isn't that an example of how ridiculous the world sounds when trying to explain what's happening right in front of them without God? Look at how ridiculous the world sounds when they're trying to explain how we all exist, how this world exists, without including God and creation. Let's say, well, you know, in the beginning there was nothing, and then it exploded, and then, you know, you were in the goop of the early soup, and out of the soup kind of tadpoled out of there, and somehow you sprouted legs and began to walk around. I'm not exaggerating too far, am I? I mean, that's ultimately where the teaching takes you, because we can't have God in it. And it's foolish and ridiculous. Well, it was foolish to think that these people were drunk. And Peter explained, they're not drunk, come on, it's early in the morning. But he quotes from this prophecy of Joel that I'm going to read to you right now. Again, if you're taking notes, this is found in Joel 2, very well known. And Peter says, what's happening right now is the fulfillment of this passage. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit, the Holy Spirit, on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And goes on to say, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions, and also on my men servants and on my maid servants, I will pour out my Spirit in those days. And Peter says, that's what's being fulfilled. Now, as a little aside, and it's relative for when we pick up on Sunday once more in the Gospel of Mark, you know what the next verses in Joel says, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke, and the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. Well, that didn't happen on Pentecost. And so between those verses where I stopped about the Holy Spirit being poured out on all flesh, and then we get into that in that day, the blood and the sun, you've got a gap of time, a gap of history. And you know what fits in that gap? The church. We don't know how long that gap is going to be, how long that time is. But you see, the start of the church began Pentecost with the fulfillment of that prophecy, as Peter himself declares. When the church is done and God pours out his wrath during the tribulation, that's when those other verses are going to come to pass. Now, that's not the same as a double fulfillment, but it's, again, basically two prophecies brought together with a big gap of time in between. And that's not the only place that that happens in the Bible, where the church is found in the middle between verses, but that's a side study for another time. So, we should not be surprised for various reasons to find these young daughters who prophesied. And we're going to still talk about what I mean by that, but let's get a couple more verses down and then we'll start digging into it. We stayed many days, and look at verse 10, a certain prophet named Agabus. He came down from Judea, so he shows up at Caesarea with Philip and the rest of them. And when he had come to us, he took Paul's belt, bound his own hands and feet, and said, thus says the Holy Spirit, so shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. Quite a dramatic scene, but the prophets were known to do that. In the Old Testament, you have a few examples of the prophets doing very dramatic things in front of the people, kind of get their attention and to tie in to the details of the message. Maybe it's tearing a garment or something, just again to get that focus. But this guy, Agabus, he's described as a prophet. And once more, this is not the first time that he's shown up either, because it's a very small passage, but in Acts chapter 11, and if you want to, you can turn to this one, just go back a few pages in your Bible there, Acts chapter 11, verse 27, and in these days, prophets came from Jerusalem to Antioch. Then one of them, named Agabus, same guy, stood up and showed by the Holy Spirit that there was going to be a great famine throughout all the world, which also happened in the days of Claudius Caesar. And then, watch the next couple of verses, then the disciples, each according to his ability, determined to send relief to the brethren dwelling in Judea. This they also did, sent it to the elders by the hands of Barnabas and Saul, or Paul. Now, we can go back to Acts 21, and let's talk about this issue of prophecy. We are reading about the church in action. Now, you should be aware that in the body of Christ, just like I said on Sunday, there's a division, even though, you know, these are brothers and sisters in the Lord, and we all love each other and believe the Bible and all that, but there is a division of opinion on issues related to the spiritual gifts as to whether the spiritual gifts we read about in the New Testament are still valid and active today for the church. Or are maybe some of them still valid and active and others aren't? Or are all of them valid and active? Just like we read the church doing in the first century, they still happens today. So you kind of have three schools of thought there, right? Hey, they're all still active? Well, some are, but some aren't, and none of them are. Now, as an aside, and just a self-serving comment, I guess, but just so that at least everybody understands where I'm coming from, this was the topic of my master's thesis, which ended up in about 100 pages. So I wrote a small book on this topic, and the only reason I say that to you is because I really, really had to study this issue. And not just propound, here's what I believe, here's what I believe. It's like, no, I had to look at what the other people believe and explain it and then deal with it. And, you know, it's a master's thesis. Very boring academic work. But very enlightening for me in the study, because the more you read how different people with different opinions than me interpret things, the stronger you get in your own point of view. For example, I've often said, if you're a little iffy about creationism, then spend a lot of time studying evolution. Really see what they teach, what they expect you to believe, and you will, if you really get into it. One of the most valuable things you can do is just study a secular evolution course. And when you really listen to them, and you say, whoa, that ain't science, that's a faith statement you just made. There's no proof of that. And you realize that's as much of a religion as anything else. And it'll make you stronger in trusting the Bible and what the Bible says about in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. There's a lot of value in that. So when it comes to spiritual gifts, the view that says that certain spiritual gifts, like the gift of prophecy, because that's what we're looking at here, Agabus, apparently Philip's daughters, the argument goes that once the Bible was completed, then we don't need that spiritual gift anymore. I'm being fair, but I'm also being brief, obviously, in describing the other alternative. That the Bible's completion meant that these things were not necessary anymore. But look at the two examples that we have before us, both with Agabus, who's described as a prophet. He was not declaring the word of God. And when it comes to declaring the word of God, I am the first in line to say, yes, God's word is complete. There is no more, thus saith the Lord, to everybody. That's what the Bible does. God's word to the world. And it is complete. Absolutely. There is no latter-day revelation. There is absolutely nothing that can be said or written by anybody that has the same authority as the Word of God. So we make that point as strong and clear as can be made right up front. But now, in action, the church in action. Look at these prophecies. Agabus wasn't saying, thus saith the Lord, it is written. He was given a prophecy about a very specific situation. Let's go back to the famine, a very specific thing. Now, no human being knows that there's going to be a famine in the future, but God, through the Spirit, told Agabus, hey, there's going to be a famine coming. And Agabus told that church. Was this a worldwide famine? No, it was a local problem for a local situation, for a local group of believers. And as a result, they took action. They said, all right, well, if there's a famine coming, you know, then we need to make sure that our brothers and sisters down there are going to have plenty of food and all that. Let's take up a collection. And you see, that sort of need for the church, that didn't stop just because we have a completed Bible. And what would have completed, let's say we had the completed Bible when that happened. How would that have had anything to do with a local famine and local believers moving to action? So, there is no reason, biblically speaking, if you look at the church, as I said, to think that somehow a spiritual gift of a prophetic word cannot and does not exist anymore today. No, of course it does. Of course it can. But as I said, to be clear, I am not suggesting that someone is going to come up and say, I have a word for the entire church from God. But no, in someone's life or in the local body of believers or a certain area, absolutely. Because maybe something's coming and God wants to warn his people. Maybe God wants to encourage someone who is in despair and sad or whatever. Like, hey, you know what's going to happen in a couple of years? There's all sorts of reasons why God might do it. And so in Paul's letters, specifically to the Thessalonians, he tells the church there, do not despise prophesying. Don't despise those things. See, in this discussion, there are many in the body of Christ that despise that. If someone says, you know what, I've got a word from the Lord that I think, you know, he wants me to share, I despise that. I can't be possibly. God doesn't do that anymore, right? Don't despise them. But then Paul goes on to say, to test all those things, prove them, and hold fast what is good. Do you begin to see a balance? Because on the one hand, what I totally dismiss as wrong is people in the church, and when I say the church, I'm talking about, you know, the body of Christ, not just like Lake Elsinore here, like I'm looking at you, you know, no. But people in the church, you go around and say, the Lord told me that you're going to do that, and the Lord told me this, and they're going around, and the Lord speaks to them multiple hours a day about everybody else's life. I'd be very cautious about that. Frankly, I think the Lord has enough to speak to our lives about our situations that's going to be a full-time job if we listen to him before he says, now, by the way, you know, share this with brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so. But that doesn't mean that he can't do it or that he doesn't do it. And so Paul's advice, if someone comes and says, hey, you know, the Lord, I was praying and you came on my heart and the Lord just spoke to me about this and I just want to share it with you. Okay, I'll receive it. I don't despise it, but I'm not necessarily going to change my life. You know, someone said, well, the Lord told me, you got to do it now. It's like, well, the Lord has my number too. He'll talk to me about my life. I appreciate it. And when maybe I begin to have some thoughts and some ideas and someone also has planted that, it's like, hey, in my own life, as an early believer, and I'm talking about like a year or two in, I really felt like because I got saved, you know, abide in the calling that you're called. I got saved as a businessman, a family business, a commission business, and I'm thinking to myself, wow, what if the Lord wants to bless me? You know, I'll be the next Chick-fil-A or Hobby Lobby or whatever, and really bless the business, and I'll have an opportunity to be able to you know, sponsor missionaries and do all this wonderful, you know, works and have Bibles translated in other languages. And, you know, and I just really felt this encouragement and this blessing to be, you know, a financial channel for the Lord for a lot of. And my wife, because she had kind of seen me in action, she says, no, God's calling you to be a pastor. He wants you to teach his word. And that just did not seem right to me. We had an argument about it. That's how spiritual I was. But ultimately, it comes down to the idea. And she wasn't telling me, so, you know, quit your job and go to, you know, it's like, no. But she was just saying, I don't think that this is God's future for you. I don't think you're going to be this salesman and all this for, you know, the rest of your life here. I think God's got a different plan. Well, God's got to speak to me. It took about a year or so, but the Lord began to work in my heart. And I realized, you know, he had worked in my wife's heart first. Now, is that a textbook idea of a prophecy? Well, I mean, I'm not going to quibble with that. But she definitely said, no, well, this is what the Lord wants you to do. And it turned out to be true. So I didn't despise it, even if I did argue. But ultimately, again, prove all things, test all things, hold fast that which is true. And I see that that's how it came to be. So, the gift of prophecy is legitimate, and it's legitimate today, but I think I've provided a lot of qualifications and boundaries that hopefully help us explain, because like with a lot of things like this, you have those who just want to shut the door and there's just absolutely no way, and then you have anyone who's open to it, they take it way to an extreme. And it's chaos, and, you know, every time you show up on a Sunday, 50 people are standing, they'll save the Lord, you know, and hold on, you know. So here we are in the early church. Philip has four daughters who have this gift, who are able to speak a prophetic word. And I also want to add this for completion's sake, not, again, to get into the weeds and the details of my master's thesis, but I noticed that there are those who want to dismiss the word prophecy by basically just saying, well, that just means speaking the word of God. And of course, we have, you know, pastors and teachers in the body of Christ, and that's what it means to prophesy. But once more, church, that's just not accurate. There is an aspect, yes, of proclaiming forth the word of God, but prophecy, and I'm sure that this is what we all think of when we hear the word, is talking about declaring something before it happens. It's just what the word means, to declare before. Prophecy is the idea of we're declaring before. It's not just teaching the Bible and you're a prophet. No, 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 no. This is not the gift of prophecy on a Wednesday night when I'm teaching the Bible. To speak before. That's prophecy. And isn't that what's happening here? Now, with all of that and talking about a practical application, that was my introduction, right? How we look to the early church and we have our own practical applications. We now go back to Paul's situation here because this is where it gets interesting as well. Verse 12. Now, when we heard these things, that these things being, of course, Agabus with his dramatic, you know, the Jews at Jerusalem are going to bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. When we heard these things, both we, that means Luke's including himself, and those from that place, so that means Philip and everybody else, they pleaded with him, with Paul, not to go up to Jerusalem. And then Paul answered, "What do you mean by weeping and breaking my heart? For I'm ready not only to be bound, but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." So when he would not be persuaded, we ceased, saying, "The will of the Lord be done." So, when Agabus gave that prophetic word, what he said is absolutely true, isn't it? Looking at it again, "Thus says the Holy Spirit, so shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles." That's exactly what's going to happen to Paul. He's going to get arrested in Jerusalem, and he's going to get turned over to the Romans. And that's what we're going to see in the last few chapters of Acts, all that taking place. Notice in Agabus' prophecy, there's no instruction about, so don't go, Paul. This is where I think we are apt to make a mistake. In our thinking, we are so quick to think, if there's danger, then avoid it. And that's not without some legitimacy when it comes to the teachings of Scripture. Jesus said, if they persecute you, it's okay to flee to the next city. Don't deny Christ, but if you can get out of there, you know, by all means, go. You know, if Christians from North Korea who face a hell on earth, if they can somehow escape, praise the Lord, right? There's nothing wrong with that. So, we have that instruction. But at the same time, the idea that if you know it's coming, then you should, is not something that Paul bought into. And you know who else didn't buy into it? The Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord knew exactly what was coming his way, didn't he? He knew everything that was going to come upon him. And it burdened him. And we see him praying in the Garden of Gethsemane and all of the issues there. But he still went forward. He didn't run away. He didn't say, let me get out to Egypt so I don't get crucified. No, he went forward. Let's hypothetically imagine that all of this pressure on Paul, don't go, Paul. But Paul, look at what's going to happen. You know, let's say he said, you're right, I better not. I'm going to take off. I know some people up in Galatia. I can kind of hang out there and I'll be safe. Sometimes when you're safe, you're not being used. What good would Paul have been to the early church hiding in a cave somewhere? You remember Elijah? What are you doing here, Elijah? Hiding in the cave. They want to kill me, Lord. You're not alone. There's others out there. I've got work for you to do. Get out of this cave and go do this and anoint this guy. And they put Elijah to work, didn't he? Can you imagine if Paul had gone and hid in a cave? Think about all of the New Testament that God had Paul write after he was captured as a prisoner. He wouldn't have been writing that from some cave out in, you know, some safe area. So, it is a legitimate prophecy telling Paul what's going to happen, warning him, if you want to use that expression. But the mistake is in thinking that Paul then is somehow in the wrong by still wanting to go. And once more, what an example we have. Here you have all these believers. Paul, you shouldn't go. Paul, you shouldn't go. But you know who was telling Paul to go? The Lord. Now, if you study this, you will find some people who actually criticize Paul for not listening to the Holy Spirit. Now, I have a rule of thumb that I start with when I'm looking at the life of Paul, is I don't ever assume that I know better than Paul or that anybody knows better than Paul, especially when it comes to the will of God. I know that Paul was not a perfect person. I know Jesus is the only one who's sinlessly perfect and all the rest of it. But the idea that, oh, you know, here's where Paul made a big mistake because he didn't listen to the crowd trying to convince him something else. As I said, when you see how the Lord used Paul in those years, including his imprisonment and so forth, it's awful hard to say, oh, what a mistake that was. What a mistake that we've got the book of Ephesians and Philippians and Colossians and, you know, Timothy epistles. Yeah, what a mistake it is that we have those that were all written by Paul when he was in prison. So that's kind of my starting point. Hey, if someone thinks they're more spiritual than Paul, have at it, but I just don't go there. So I think that we can look at this, and now I'd like you to go back. I remembered my promise. Back to verse 4. Because I think we needed to understand this before we can understand verse 4. They told Paul through the Spirit not to go up to Jerusalem. So I do not believe that God's Spirit through these individuals was telling Paul not to go. But the idea is they're telling Paul not to go. Just like these guys are telling Paul not to go. Why? Because the Spirit has shown to them, hey, Paul's going to get arrested in Jerusalem. Oh, no, then he shouldn't go. It's basically the same thing here. And, you know, they're not telling Paul anything new. Last week, when we were in chapter 20, look at verse 22. Just turn back a page. Acts 20, verse 22. This is in his farewell words to the leaders of the Ephesus church. Verse 22, see now I go bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem. He's a free man, but he says I'm bound in the Spirit, meaning I've got to do this. It's almost like I have no choice. I have no will. Why? Because the Lord wants me to go. I'm bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will happen to me. I don't know all the details, all the specifics. Verse 23, except that the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me. This was not new to Paul. Every city that Paul had been in at this part of his life and his travels, there was someone with a gift of prophecy saying, Paul, you're going to Jerusalem? The Lord says you're going to get arrested there. And he kept hearing that over and over again. But he kept going. So I understand at least why someone might think, you see, God was going out of his way to warn Paul. He kept giving him warning after warning after warning, but Paul was too stubborn to listen. I just don't buy it. I don't buy it. Paul knew what he was doing, and I believe that those prophetic words about his future imprisonment, all that, are in many ways much like what Jesus knew was coming. Hey, it's going to be tough. It's going to be rough. And if, you know, this is going to happen to you. And yet he kept going. And that's why his words are so heavy there that I just read. But looking at it again, what do you mean by weeping and breaking my heart? And it's very strong in the Greek, that idea of breaking my heart, you know. I'm ready not only to be bound. You think I fear being thrown in jail? Look at what Paul's already gone through, by the way. Is he safe in some of these Gentile towns? Far from it. He's been had rocks thrown at him. He's already been thrown in jail in other places and so forth. So it's not like there's any place safe for a man like Paul, a man of God. I'm ready not only to be bound, but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. What can they do to me? And Paul was getting a little older, and he had served so faithfully. And I'm not saying he had a death wish or anything like that, but just the idea like, hey, if the Lord calls me now, then the will of the Lord be done. And so we're going to stop there rather than digging in further that, but hopefully that helps us understand. Again, don't think that Paul's making a mistake here, but God is showing him legitimately through a spiritual gift that is still legitimate today. Again, notice that a personal thing about someone's personal life and so forth. The problem was in their trying to interpret, you know, how it's supposed to be. And God had to speak to Paul, and God had spoken to Paul, and I believe that with all my heart. I don't think that Paul was somehow stubborn or wrong or somehow out of touch with God in that moment. Far from it. But I would close with this thought. As Paul says, hey, I'm willing to die for the name of Jesus. I think that there are many Christians, and I would hazard probably everyone in this room, that if we knew for certainty, let's say we were like an underground church or whatever, but there was someone from the, you know, secret police with a machine gun that was going to kill all the Christians that came out of that room. Or I think that I'm ready to die for the Lord. I mean, if that's going to happen, I don't fear death. I don't fear martyrdom. I'm willing to die for Jesus. I think that most Christians will say that, and will say it with sincerity and really mean it. It's not just words. It's a desire of the heart. But may I suggest that dying for Jesus is a lot easier than living for him. Like I said, if there was just no escape, no chance of, you know, fleeing or whatever, there was a guy there with his gun and you're in line and he's going to put a bullet right between your eyes and send you to glory, all right, do it. I'm not saying you might not have a little fear, a little, you know, tears or whatever, but just, we're going to get in that line. You're not going to have to drag me out of the chairs or something like that. No, don't take me. No, well, let's do it then. If that's the will of the Lord be done. But it's living for Jesus, and especially in our world today. Taking a stand for him, speaking up for him, speaking the truth. We're told, and you hear me all the time, speak the truth in love. But we are living in a time that no matter how loving you are in the way you deliver it, no matter how many qualifications you have about, I don't condemn those people, I just don't agree, and it doesn't matter. You're the bigot, you're in the wrong, and you're going to be hated. And so a lot of Christians say, well, I just don't want to, you know, say anything. And so to live for Jesus in our world right now, that takes guts. But we can't do it in our own strength either. And once more, I go back to where we began, the importance of being filled with the Holy Spirit, being lost in him. You know, when you're lost in your thoughts, you're kind of worthless to everyone around you because you're just, you know. But when you're lost in the Lord, that's when you're the most alert to what's around you because you're so in tune with God. And you're in tune and you see a need or you see someone who has help or you see an injustice or whatever it is. And that, when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you're being guided and led by him, when you're lost in him, you're the most found you've ever been. And that's when the church is really dangerous to the enemy. And so Paul was dangerous to the enemies of God and to the devil himself, who of course calls the shots over the enemies of God. Paul was dangerous. He was persecuted. They drove around. They tried to shut him up, but he kept going. And now, even those closest to him, his brothers and sisters in Christ, his own traveling companions that he's been living with and his good friends and these other places, no, Paul, don't. He says, don't break my heart. I'm ready. I'm going to do what the Lord calls me to do. I wonder if maybe it was a little self on their end. We don't want to lose you, Paul. Paul, don't go. Why? I don't want to lose you. Hey, we're all going to lose everybody. Unless the Lord returns and the people who have been at this church for a long time have lost countless dear friends, brothers and sisters in Christ over the years. A lot of funerals. Because that happens for us all. But we never really lose each other. Because we're reunited forever and we'll live together forever. How wonderful that is. And that's all because of what Jesus has done. And Jesus is the one who told us. And Paul listened, apparently. Don't fear those who can kill your body. After that, they can't do anything to you. Just fear the Lord. Live for him. Worry about what he thinks, not what others think, whether they're Christian or non-Christian alike. Be pleasing in his sight. That's our desire. Live for him. Let's pray. Lord, thank you again for this time in your word and to look at these things and look at your dear servant Paul's life. Just how wonderful it's going to be to meet him someday. And Lord, to help us try to rightly divide your word and bring an understanding, not just of what was happening in Paul's life and back then, but again, as we tried to do today, how this matters in our lives today, because you are there and you do guide and you do speak and you do direct. And sometimes it takes a while for us, for you to connect through us. So maybe you speak to somebody else first and put that thought, that little seed planted. We praise you for these things, Lord. We praise you for our salvation. We praise you for all you are and all that you have done and will do for us. Bless us as we go forth now. Watch over us. Keep us safe, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.